Listening Library presents Alvin Ho, Allergic to Camping, Hiking, and Other Natural Disasters by Lenore Look, read for you by Everette, Plen. Chapter 1. Believing in Henry. You will know some things about me if you have read a book called Alvin Ho, Allergic to Girls, School, and Other Scary Things. But you won't know all about me, so that is why there is now the second book. In case you missed it, my name is Alvin Ho. I was born scared and I am still scared. Things that scare me include long words, especially hippopotamonstrosesquipedaliophobia, which means fear of long words. Punctuation, except for exclamation points. Exclamations are fantastic. The dark, which means I have nyctophobia. The great outdoors. What's so great about it? Lots of things can happen when you're outdoors. Hurricanes, tornadoes, mudslides, landslides, the end of the world. I'm scared of many more things than that. But if I put all my scares on one list, it would mean years of therapy for me. And I already go to therapy once a month, on account of it's supposed to help me not be so scared. But my brother Calvin says, when you're born a certain way, that's the way you'll always be. So you might as well hug your inner scaredy cat. My brother Calvin, he gives good advice. I'm not so good with advice. I can never think of any, except maybe this. When in doubt, always ask, what would Henry do? Henry is Henry David Thoreau. He's a dead author, which is really creepy. But he is also our school hero, which is not so creepy. And he was a lot like me. He had stuff figured out, even when he was little. He was born in Concord, Massachusetts, just like me. And, gulp, he died in Concord, too. Of course, I could never say, what would Henry do at school, where I never say anything. This is on account of school is mortifying, and when I am mortified, which means totally scared to death, I can't scream, I can't talk, I can't even grunt. Nothing comes out of my mouth, no matter how hard I try. Having a lot in common with Henry can be very useful. For example, we learned in music class today that Henry played the flute, and whenever he played, a mouse would come to listen, and Henry would feed it with the extra pieces of cheese that he kept in his pocket. My brother has a flute, I told the gang on the bus after school. He rented it for lessons, and we have cheese in the refrigerator. Let's go, said Pinky. So when the bus stopped at the end of my driveway, the gang followed me to my house. Usually, it's a tricky business getting them to play with me unless it's Pinky's idea. Pinky is the biggest boy and the leader of the gang, and no one plays with me unless Pinky does. Except for Flea. Flea plays with me no matter what. But the problem with Flea is that she's a girl, and girls are annoying. Fortunately, my mom was at work, and my gung-gung, who comes to watch us after school, was fast asleep on the sofa. So I left the gang in the kitchen and tiptoed past the sofa to fetch Calvin's flute from the top of the piano where he had put it for safekeeping. No problem. The only problem was Annabelle. She's 4, she's my sister, and she was wide awake following me everywhere and getting in my way as usual. That's Calvin's, said Annabelle. I stopped. I pretended I didn't see Annabelle, but it's hard not to see her. She's like a stoplight in the middle of my life, and there's just no avoiding her. I can't go anywhere without going past her or taking her with me if I'm in a hurry. But Calvin's practicing his karate moves at Stevie's house, I said. And I need his flute for a little experiment. What experiment? Asked Annabelle. Well, you live in Concord, Massachusetts, don't you? I asked. Annabelle nodded. You believe in Henry David Thoreau, don't you? Annabelle nodded again. Well, then if you keep quiet, I said, I'll let you watch. So Annabelle kept quiet. First, I put Calvin's flute together. Then, I went back into the kitchen where the gang was waiting and looked for some cheese. Actually, there was quite a lot of cheese, all chopped up and zipped inside a plastic bag. It was very yummy. And we were hungrier than a pack of starving mice. By the time we finished snacking, there were only a few crumbs left to put in my pocket. But I was sure that our teacher, Miss P, had said that Henry had pieces of cheese, not crumbs. I heard pieces, too, not crumbs, said Sam, who usually always pays better attention in class than I do. A mouse isn't going to come for crumbs. So we cobbled all our crumbs together to make a piece of cheese, which I put in my pocket. Then I picked up Calvin's flute. put it to my lips and blew. It sounded like a sick worm blowing its nose. So I blew again, harder. Let me try, said Pinky, snatching the flute and pieces of cobbled cheese from my pocket. He sounded worse than I did. Then Nia took a turn, then Sam, then Jules, and Eli and Hobson. By the time Calvin's flute was finally passed to Flea, it was drooling worse than our dog Lucy on a hot day. And the cobbled cheese that ended up in her pocket was hardly recognizable as cheese, except for the smell. Worse, there was no mouse anywhere. It was not a good sign. Even worse, a car was pulling into our driveway with Calvin inside. You're busted now, said Annabelle. Alvin Ho, said Flea, this is gross. I'm going home. Then Flea handed me the flute, picked up her backpack, and marched off just like that. If there's anything good about Flea, it's this. She knows when to call it quits. But the gang did not. The problem is that we need to be outside in the woods, said Nia. Who can figure things out like a detective? Henry took his flute on his walks in the woods, where there are not only mice, but chipmunks and squirrels and bats. That's how Henry did it. Who's coming to Walden Woods with me? Asked Pinky. No one moved. No one said a word. Then Pinky turned and headed for the door. Last one there's a chicken butt, he said. And before I knew it, the gang rushed out. If I were not scared of the woods, or if I had had on my Firecracker Man gear, I would have run after them. Firecracker Man isn't afraid of anything, but I am afraid of everything, especially the woods. They are full of trees, and Walden Woods behind my house is the creepiest of all. It is full of big stones, too, carved with the words of Henry David Thoreau and other, dead people. If you read their words and stay long enough, you can even feel them sitting around having a chat. Lucky for me, the gang forgot the flute. But unlucky for me, Flea was right. Calvin's flute was really gross. It was sticky and slimy and dripping with drool. And I was holding it when Calvin came in, dressed to kill. There are many advantages to being Calvin. 1, you're 9 years old, almost 10. 2, you can haul firewood. 3, your fingers fit in a bowling ball. 4, you can crash your bike without crying. 5, you can do karate. 6, you can kick my butt. There's only one advantage to being me. 1. I'm not sure what it is yet, but there must be something. Okay, I can clean a flute like nobody's business and put it back in its case and put the case back where it belongs for safekeeping. Okay, Calvin, I asked. Okay, said Calvin, but he was not okay. He was still mad at me. So I gave him one of my best carved sticks, which is supposed to be a walking stick, but is especially useful for digging holes in the yard. Then Calvin, Annabelle, and I ran outside. Digging holes is fantastic. It makes you forget your troubles, and when Calvin gets started, there's no telling what he'll forget. Usually everything. He digs better than anybody. He's a regular backhoe. So by the time the delivery truck screeched up our driveway and dropped off a big box, thwomp, we were buds again. We dropped our sticks and ran over. To Mr. Alvin Ho, said the label. Calvin karate chopped the box and I tore it open with my bare hands. Inside, gasp, was Houdini in a box, do-it-yourself escape kit. Wow, said Calvin. What is it, asked Annabelle. It's, said Calvin, it's... Then Calvin said nothing. I said nothing. What do you say when the best thing that has ever happened to you just dropped in your driveway? Chapter 2. The Fantastic Straitjacket Escape. I ripped open the kit right there in the driveway. Inside there were pencils, stickers, handcuffs, a handcuff key, a rope, a Houdini's Greatest Escapes DVD, and a gold card. Alvin Ho, gold member of Houdini in a Box Do-It-Yourself Escapes. Calvin whistled. Dude, he said. I bet it's from Uncle Dennis, said Annabelle. And sure enough, there was another card that said, Happy birthday, sport. Love, Uncle Dennis. It was not my birthday, but my Uncle Dennis, who lives in Boston, didn't know that. He's a cool dude. He butters his toast on both sides. He can never remember our birthdays exactly, But he sends something whenever he thinks it's our birthday.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.